So you are able to see the slides, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So anyway, so before we start, you see, so last class, we were discussing about these bolted connections. So bearing capacity and others, we have discussed in the previous class and we have solved a tutorial, okay? So the one thing what we started was tension connection. So this we discussed essentially in the hungers, okay? So this formula is very simple and straightforward, okay? There is nothing this one. But only thing, what you have to keep it in mind is whenever you are having a tension connection, say, okay? So because this load axis bolts, this will be slightly different. So and then sometimes, these plates, this may be flexible and this may start, the bending also. So when you have these type of issues, so this crowbar, say, or prying bar, we say, okay? So that is to pull out nails. So obviously, you see at the end points, say, so these are the end points where, you will get some additional force, which we call as a prying force or, this Q value, okay? So what our code says is, if you are designing these type of bolts, say, you know anyway the tension load, but you have to add some QU, and approximately it is 10 to some 20% kind of a thing itself. And how tension member fails also, like, they say, the bending moment diagram you can draw, and then, these are the plastic hinges like that also, theories are there. So this is what, so this is a very, very serious problem in tension members. Of course, not only in civil engineering, but in mechanical, when you are boilers, you see the mechanical equipment, pressure is there, so these type of problems. So these bolts, you have to design for this prying forces also. So this is a very important thing, okay? So the other choice is, so if you want to decrease the prying force, say, one thing is increasing it, that is the end distance, say. So this, if you increase, the forces will get decreased, or the thickness of the plates, say, if you can increase it, T1, T2, then maybe, things will be fine. And this B, that is a distance between this bolt axis and then this load axis, say, this should be reduced actually. Okay, so if both of them are same, then there is no problem. But because of this, you have this additional, the prying force or something which is coming into this one. And when you are having a lot of bolts, so this one will be subjected to, you followed, right? The more, this prying force also. So this IS code formula also I have shown you, but this is very complex. But generally designers, what they do is, whatever load you have, say, some 10 to 30%, you can, you follow it, you can use it. So that is how, it goes, okay? So now, so this also we discussed HSFG bolts also. Two types are there. So one is a parallel wasted shank. This is based on the design philosophy. So parallel shank, what do you mean by parallel shank? So yesterday's class I told you, right? Parallel shank means, what do we, what is the philosophy here? No.
Does not slip at serviceability load, but it slips in ultimate load.
Excellent. So wasted means?
Does not slip in either serviceability load or the...
So this ultimate load, so that is the thing. So wasted shank means there is only frictional capacity, but here you have bearing capacity and others also, okay? So this also I told you, so once it has slipped, say, so design of HSFG is same as your, the ordinary bolt itself, okay? So this is the thing. So this is the equation which is given in the IS code for frictional capacity also, okay? So this also we showed, and I showed you also how to calculate friction, and this problem also we have done also, okay? So then we just came to this block shear also. So this block shear also is a very, very important, okay? We will discuss once again this in tension members also, when we go to tension members. But just, you see, I wanted to mention this one, okay? So here also, you have tension plane, shear plane. So one among these two, one will be weak, other one will be strong. The stronger one fails through rupture, the weaker one fails through yielding, okay? So this is the terminology we use. And what will be the paths means, it can do variety of ways. Like this, it can break path 1, path 2, path 3. So you may have to calculate for all possible paths, and then whichever is the minimum, say, that is the design strength for the block shear. So our code gives, two formulas are there. One, like you see, weaker plane yielding, the stronger plane tearing. So shear yielding, tension tearing, or shear tearing, or shear fractures are tension yielding. So two formulas are given in our code itself. So if you substitute, you know, those, and the most important thing here is, you know, the calculating, you see, the areas only. So if you know how to calculate this areas, say, that is, you know, AVG, ATN, then ATG, then AVN, say, these are described in the code also, then the formulas. So then, you know, you can easily calculate. So the last class we have discussed, you see, how to find out AVG, AVN. So this I hope all of you know. So now you substitute in that formula, say, so that is, you know, VDBS1, then VDBS2, say, okay. So substitute, you know, it is just a substitution only. So the first one, if you substitute, it turns out to be 218.86 kilonewtons. And the second formula, say, if you substitute those thing, VDS, you know, DBS2 or something. So this turns out to be 231.34 kilonewtons. So two things will be there. So now what is the block shear strength of this one? So among these two, which one you will take? No. Now, two formulas are there. So now which formula you will take? No.
218.8.
Whichever is lower, that is the strength. So what is the understanding here? How this one is going to fail? BS1, that is the mode first one. So shear yielding, you followed, right? Tension tearing kind of a thing, you see. That is how, you know, we can identify actual. Okay. So this is how we come to the block shear. We will discuss this in great details once we go to tension members also. So there also the same problem comes. At least here you should be thorough how to calculate the areas. Once again, we will come back to this one in tension members. Now, another most important thing is before we close this bolted connection, say, one is to find out, you see, the efficiency of the joints and other things becomes very important. Now, whenever there is a joint, say, we already have seen actual, okay, so two types of failures are there. One is a bolt failure, that is how the bolts fail, or the plate failure also is very important, okay. So this also have to be calculated. So I showed you, like, you know, the previous slides, if you see, say, okay. Where we discussed about the mode shapes, how bolts fails. Yes. Yes, this was, I think, yes, not this one. So this, if you see, say, okay, so bearing failure, shear failure, all these things we have seen actually. Now, the most important thing is this type of failure also, that is tension failure of the plate, where the plate, you know, it just gets, you followed, right, teared from the connection. So this also is very important. So you know how to calculate all the mode shapes, block shear, everything we know. So this becomes very important, okay? So this also have to be calculated. So this also we will see in tension members, but you followed, right? We can, you know, I will just brief you also. So this is how, you know, we calculate this tension, you know, that capacity, say, or, you know, this, you know, the tearing capacity of our, the plate itself, but the near the joint. So this is a plate failure and then bolt failure. So when a joint fails, so when I say failure of a joint, say, that means, you know, one is a bolt can fail or the plate, the tearing of the plate, we say. So this also is a possibility. So now to calculate tearing of the plate, say, so our IS code in tension members, okay. So if you see that chapter in your IS 800, automatically this formula has been given. So AN is the net tensile area, they say. This anyway is ultimate strength of the plate, and then this is a safety factor, which you can get from that, you know, the that, you know, the table, which we gamma MB, we seen, right, 1.25, 1.1 or something. So this comes from the table. Now to compute this area as a net tensile area for the plate, okay. Now if you want to compute net tensile area of the bolt, say, so what is the net tensile area of the bolt? So if I want to calculate a bolt, what is the expression?
0.78 into pi d square by
4. Excellent. Okay, that is for the bolt. Now we have to calculate this area for the plate. Okay. So this expression, you see, we use actual. Okay. Now this quantity, we will, this comes for standard grids. This is not required for, you know, chain bolting, or, you know, the bolts are organized in a, you know, row column kind of a thing. This may not be required. This itself is sufficient actually. So this is the width of the plate, and N is number of the holes, how many bolt holes are there, and DH, say, this is the diameters of the holes itself. So that is the thing. So like, for example, if I have these type of bolting, say, so DH is the diameter of the bolt. So now I have to calculate, you see, the tension failure, say. So now in this direction, say, there are three three holes are there. So now, you know, so this plate has lost, you know, three areas. So here the cross section has been lost, this area, you know, the whole area. So that has been lost from the plate itself. Suppose if there was no holes there, then the area will be simply B times D only, okay? So there are no holes actually. So B times D, that means it is a solid plate. But once you have made holes, say, okay, so it has lost the cross-sectional area. So you have to remove this, you know, the area from the, you know, this width. So B minus, you know, this N times DH. It is not the diameter of the bolt. It is a diameter of the hole because, you know, that much area has been removed from the plate itself. Now, suppose if I have a staggered grid, say, like, you know, one hole here, one hole here, there is no, like, you see, the pitch is not constant, so pitch is varying and you followed, right? So then, you know, so the gauge distance also is different, pitch distance also is different, say. So then, you know, you may have to can the plate may tear in variety of fashion. It may tear, so here the plate may tear like this, okay, or it may tear here itself, or the plate may hit tear, you followed, right? This type of mode shape, or it may hear like this also. So all kinds of things we have to evaluate, okay? We will see in the tension members. So several mode shapes have to be done. But now if you take some simple chain bolting, say, then, you know, here or here the failure, the play, the things are going to remain same itself, okay? So this formula, this expression is going for staggered grip. We will see also in tension member how this formula comes. But, you know, if it is a chain bolting, so then this not required. So B minus N times D into T. So once you know A and say substitute here, you will get this, you know, that tearing capacity of the plate itself. So now once you know this, and the bolt capacity, plate failure, both of them you calculate, whichever is lower, say, that gives you the, you know, the strength of that joint, okay? So this is how, you know, we calculate this strength of a joint, that is from the plate as well as from the bolt. Bolt anyway, all of, you know, so now from the plate also. So this is how we calculate. So now once you know this one, say, so we can find out efficiency of the joint. All this is also very, very, you know, the important thing they do in the design, like strength of the bolted joint. So strength of a bolted joint means two things are there, that is the strength of the bolt you have to calculate, then the plate also, okay? So whichever is lower, say, that is nothing but the strength of the bolted joint. Now divided by strength of the solid plate. See, if there was no, you know, if the plate was solid, say, without any holes, and if it was like a continuous thing, so what is the strength of a solid plate and strength of the bolted joint? Because you have punched holes and then put bolts for transfer of the load, so load can be transferred by a solid plate also. But now instead of solid plate, you see, you have done this bolting kind of a thing, say. So there you would take the ratio of this one, you see. Obviously, this gives you, you know, the efficiency of the joint. Some textbooks, they write a strength of a joint by strength of a solid plate. They will calculate all the overall thing and they do. Some textbooks say, or some people, they do per pitch length also. Like, you see, per bolt or per, you followed it, pitch length kind of a thing also. They calculate these numbers itself, okay? So now the same problems which we saw in the last class, that 16 mm, you know, 18 mm is HSFG bolts, we have done in the last class the same problem, okay? This problem itself, now I want to find out the strength we have seen, but efficiency I want to find out, say, of this joint. So now we already calculated for the bolts. See, like the bolts capacity, one bolt, it was 71.34 if slip is not permitted, okay? So then we said the capacity is 428.04, okay? So now for this one, I want to calculate, you see, the plate strength also, because my joint means, you know, I have to do bolts, I have to do for the plate itself. So if I use the same formula, so I should know the width of the plate. So width of the plate was, how much is the width of the plate? So in this problem, the width has not been given actually for the plate connection. So this is the width of the plate. Now how much will be the width of the plate here? So you know the, you know, diameter of the bolts, and he has given you, you see, the pitch also. See, you know, the three pitch is, you see, 70 mm each, gauge is also 70 mm, and then the end distance, say, is, you know, the 40 mm. So what will be the width of the plate? See, pitch is 70 and gauge is also 70. So this hole, say, so the distance is, you followed, right, 70 mm, okay? So two things are there. So this is also 70 mm. And the end distance, say, is, you know, 40 mm. So this is, you know, the end distance. So this is, you see, 40 mm here. And this side also, it is, you followed it, the 40 mm. So now what will be the width of the plate? So this becomes, you see, width of the plate generally is a design variable. Suppose if I add one more row, say here, then you know the width will have to increase actually, okay? So the width is a design variable. So now, so here in this problem, say, so the width will be, so 40 plus 70 plus 70 plus 40. So if I will write, you know, there. So the width of the plate, say, so this will give you, you see, 40, one end distance plus 70, then 70, then plus 40. So this turns out to be, you see, 220 mm. So this is the width of the plate itself, and you know all other areas. So now the tensile that is for the plate, say, so this gives me, you see, 0.9 into, and it is no staggered grid, it is just proper bolting. So B minus N times, you know, DH, you followed. So this is the width of the plate after I subtract the holes, and Fu by, you see, gamma times, you see, M1. This is a safety factor. So now this turns out to be 0.9, okay, into, you substitute all those things, say 220. Now how many holes are there?
Six
are there, but if you see one row, say, see, we are looking at one row. Where is that problem? So plate may tear off here. So tearing capacity, or the plate may tear at the first row, or the plate may tear at the second row. So now if I take a given row, say, given column, sorry, how many holes are there? Because we are discussing plate tearing. How many are there?
Three,
not six, okay. Six means over. Plate cannot tear off, right? Here once, two times a tear means it is not a single plate. So this portion is one plate, this portion is another, that will never happen actually, okay, one tear itself. So one row is three bolts are there. So you have to subtract, you see, three times the holes. Now what is the diameter of the bolt? Where is that, you see, diameter of the bolt, how much they have given? Are connected, 20 mm diameter. So now what is the size of the hole? So this is a bolt diameter. What will be the size of the hole? If it is a standard kind of a thing, say, so then, you know, 2 mm if you put, okay, the size of the hole. So then you see, two, if we give this type of a clearance, say, through 3 into 22. Now here one more thing is, a thickness have to be estimated. Now here what is the plate thickness? What are the plate thicknesses here?
16 and 18.
Which one you should use here in the calculation?
16.
Now, because that is the lowest. 18 if you use, obviously it will be higher value, but the other plate may fail actual, okay? So 16 you dump. So now you multiply by 410, that is ultimate strength, okay, because it is Fe410, he has already mentioned here. And you have the safety factor, I think 1.25 something, and 10 to the power minus 3 for units consistency. So this turns out to be 727.37 kilonewton. So this is the, that is tensile rupture, say, the tensile, you know, the strength of the, you know, the followed, the tearing thing of the plate itself. Now for the solid plate, say, to find out efficiency, I have to calculate for the solid plate also. So for solid plate, same calculation only. Only thing is 0.9 into B times D, no hole, you followed it, subtraction actually. Okay, so this turns out to be, you see, the solid plate, so 1039.10 kilonewton. So this is for the solid plate. You followed. So this is for the solid plate, that is ultimate strength or whatever, because we have used Fu here. So for the solid plate, so now I have to find out my efficiency. Now what is my efficiency? So strength of the solid plate I already know, 1039.10 or something. Now what will be the strength of the bolted joint? So for the plate it is 727.37, okay, that is the value you followed, it has been given. So now you followed, right? And what is for the bolts, what is the capacity? So bolts, I think we calculated in the last class. So for bolts, how much is this one? So for all the 6 bolts, how much it came? You can see this number.
428.
Now for the plate, it is 727, which is low.
428 bolts.
So the bolts, 428.04 into 100, some percentage if you want to calculate, say. So this turns out to be, you see, 41.19% efficiency. So this is the efficiency of the joint actual, okay? So this is how, you know, you have to calculate. Now suppose if the slip is permitted, say, so then what you should do? So which way I think will change?
Normal design without exercise. with the ordinary design only, but which parameter has to be changed? See, this is going to change BTDN.
No, sir.
This is not going to change. Only bolt thing only will change. The bearing strength, shear strength. So you can calculate. I will just give you the numbers here. So the shear capacity of the bolts. And now since it is HS, you followed it, FG bolt. And your 1040 is that yield, 117.68 it turns out to be. Then bearing capacity, say. This I think is straightforward. For this bolt is 160.06 kilonewtons. So finally the shear only governs, okay. So the total capacity, the bolt strength will be, you see, 6 times 117.68. So this turns out to be 706.08 kilonewtons. So this is the strength of the bolt. Now you tell me, what is efficiency of the joint? Now, what is, which one you will take? Plate is 727. Now the strength of the bolts have been increased actually, because bearing and shear has come into picture. No? 706 turns out to be. So now if I calculate the efficiency, so which is small, bolt or plate?
Bolt.
Bolt only. So finally this efficiency turns out to be 67.95%. Okay, for the second case. So that is how you have to do these calculations. Okay. So this way you can find out the efficiency of a joint, and per pitch length also sometimes they do, or overall also you can do, but you followed it. This is how we calculate the strength and other things also for the joints. So anyway, so with this, as far as our bolted connections, a lab joint, butt joint is fine. We will come to movement connections, that is a beam to column connections, say, that we will cover after some point of a time, after we cover this welding and, the tension members. So then once again, we will come to this one, because the other connections, the movement connection, eccentric connections, the movement resisting connections, you can do by welding also. So after we cover that, we will come back to that problem itself. So as far as for the time being, lab joint, butt joint is sufficient actually, okay, as far as our course is concerned. So now before we close our lab joint, that simple connection. So what we have discussed is simple connections, okay. That eccentric movement resisting we have not discussed, that we will discuss after some point of a time. We will come back to that itself. And now in so simple connections, you see, we close with this itself, that is lap and butt joint. So before we move to welding, say, so this is your checklist actually. Okay, so if you are able to answer these 17 questions, means you are doing fine. Now tell me, what's the design philosophy, sir, of a bolted joint? Tell me.
Sir, one doubt.
Tell me.
Sir, in the before question, when we saw slip versus without slip, we had slip permitted is much more stronger than without slip.
Yes.
So
why do we
look at HSFG bolt, we look at friction more than shear and bearing, right?
Yes.
So why is it that even in HSFG case, friction is less powerful than?
No. Yes. See, friction, how friction, see, how you are developing friction. See, the bolt doesn't have any, this one, the bolt is a very, very strong bolt. It is grade 10.9, okay? Its strength is 10,000, 1040, yield strength also is very high. The bolt is of strong material. How are you generating friction?
Plate to plate
contact. No, plate is there, but how are you are doing, right? The tightening of the bolt actual, okay? So the clamp action or something, that is going to give you the frictional capacity, okay? But the bolt is a very high strength bolt. So it obviously its capacities will be very high, shear capacity, because, its yield strength itself is 0.9 times, the 10,040. So this will be very strong. Bearing and shear only will be very strong. But the design, what you have to do, as already I showed you, that parallel shank bolt, say. See, now this problem, what we are doing is, see, these two connections are there. This is the one. You can see this figure.
Yes, sir.
So this is how the frictional capacity will be this much only. You followed. After this, this will be very high. See, how frictional capacity will be more than the bearing capacity. What happens if frictional capacity is more than bearing capacity, say? Then it means like ordinary bolt, like 400. So ordinary bolts, if you tighten, what happens? If you take ordinary bolt, you tighten it, say, very, very strong to generate friction. What happens to that bolt? See, friction you are generating only by clamp. See, you are generating by that clamp action. That is, you are tightening the nut, only you are getting friction. If I take 4.6 bolt and then I tighten it to generate friction, what happens? No.
It cannot stand that much strength.
No, because why it cannot stand that much strength? Because before your friction comes, its bearing capacity, shear capacity will be so low, say, automatically the bolt breaks. You followed?
Yes, sir.
So if you want more friction capacity, so what should happen?
It should be stronger.
It should be strong. But strong means, what do you mean by strong?
It should have higher yield than normal bearing capacity.
No, whatever, higher capacity. That is, you see, generally bolt fails via this one only. You followed, right? Bearing and shear only, the bolt can fail. Bolt, you followed, this is only the failure for a bolt, shear or this itself. But the bolt is a very, very high strong bolt, say. So if although you tighten the nut, you know, it is able to withstand this one. So it will generate this friction. You followed?
Yes, sir.
Now, another thing also, see, that is what we told. Another important thing in design is, suppose you want the friction capacity, say, you know, the friction capacity should itself take all the loads, say, okay? So then you have to go for wasted shank bolt. So now what we do there is, instead of, if you want to design it's a wasted shank bolt, so the same problem, then, you know, you instead of 6 bolts, you may require 9 bolts or you may require 10 bolts. So 10 bolts means, once again, is economical, you know, because these HSFG bolts are very, you followed it, expensive bolts, that problem comes. So the HSFG bolt means it is not its friction capacity is more than the other capacity, okay? Bolt means always a shear and bearing only will be higher only. That is the capacity of the bolt. Because the shear and bearing capacity is so high, say, you can use an additional advantage. What it has is, you can clamp and that, you can tighten the nut such that, you know, the friction also can be provided. That is a design. That is a philosophy. Is it fine?
So no, is it like it has an advantage on serviceability?
Yes, you can say. It's up to you. If you can make the friction only to take, you know, serviceability as well as ultimate also. So then number of bolts will be more. You follow?
Yes, sir.
So if you take a bolt individually, friction or whatever, which one governs?
Ordinary bolt.
Ordinary, no, bearing capacity or the shear only will govern, okay, the failure of a bolt. So these only are the final. But since its bearing capacity, its shear capacity is very, very high, say, so you can use it additionally tightening, and then, you know, the friction can be made so that there is no slip or something, you know, it happens. Okay?
Okay, sir.
See, like, for example, you know, in our IIT, say, chemistry lab, they have brought one electron microscope or something, you know. So now, suppose if it is hosted in a steel building, say, then, you know, for them, you see, 1 mm displacement also is a problem. So, you know, you have to use HSFG, and that building bolts, they have to be designed as wasted shank. If you want an ultimate load also, there should be no slip, no displacement also. So this is a design, you know, the criteria. But the more number of bolts are required, and it becomes expensive. So bolt means shear and bearing only, whether it is HSFG or this one. But HSFG, additional advantage is you can tighten them very strong and make a friction also that you can generate with that. That's all only. Okay. Don't think HSFG means, you know, friction comes and you followed, right? Shear bearing will be low. No. See, if shear bearing are low, say, then you cannot even tighten the bolt. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Because its bearing shear are high only, you are able to do that one. Okay? So anyway, fine. So now coming to the checklist, say, okay? Now to answer this question, what's the design philosophy of a bolted joint or any connection, say, what is the main assumption you do? Starting, I told you first this one.
All the bolts have the same load, right?
Excellent. That is one design philosophy. Then what is another most important point I told you? So in a structure, you want a failure, first failure should happen where? At a joint or the member?
Joint.
Why? No. Where you want the failure to happen, at the joint or the member?
Joint.
Joint. I think you followed, right? We have heard. See, what is that I told you? The first slide.
depends on the cost. If the member is more costly, then we want it at the joint. Otherwise, we want it at the member.
This is what we said. Can you see this slide? You remember the second slide or third slide I told you. What is the design philosophy? Which one you want? Joint to fail or member to fail? You are able to see the slide, right? What did we say in the third slide in the starting class? No. Which one you want to fail now? You know, you tell me.
Member to fail.
Now, why? You remember at that time we told economical design, members then safety also. Nah, see, because member failure is ductile, but connection failure, you have seen, no? The plate, if it shears off, say, what happens? Block shear failure, if it happens, what happens to your build? What type of failure it is? It is becoming two pieces, you know? So two piece means you followed, right? Gone only. So now, what is the design philosophy? Now you tell me.
Member should fail before.
Please remember, okay? It's like, you know, after, you know, where is that checklist? Yes. So be careful. Okay. So we always design connection should never fail. Member should fail, not the connection. So this is a very, very important thing. Okay. And now what is the shear area of the bolt? So if I give a bolt, so what is the shear area? If it is in the shank, say, what is the area of a shear?
Pi
d square by 4. So this is a shear area. What is the tensile area of the bolt?
0.78 times shear area.
Excellent. 0.78. What is the bearing area of the bolt if T is the thickness of the plate? If T is the thickness, D is the diameter. D times?
P.
D times T. So this is the projected, you remember, right? The bearing area. What does 4.6 means?
400.
Grade of bolt.
Grade of bolt only. What is the 4? What does the 4.6 means? What it tells you? What is that 4?
400 ultimate strength and
then yield strength
240 approximately.
So 0.6 times into 6 fours are 24. Okay, 240 is the strength. 8.8 means
800 and 640.
Now, apart from that, what does the 4.6 tells you? What type of bolt it is? Ordinary or HSFG?
Ordinary.
8.8 means
HSFG.
Because why it is called as HSFG? Because its ultimate strength, yield strength are very, very high. That's why you say HSFG, we call them. Okay. Now, what do you mean by stress concentration factor? Where did we say this one? So, if I have a board, plate with a hole, So, where is the stress and subjected to uniaxial tension or whatever? Say, where is stress concentration? What is stress concentration?
It goes from constant to 3 times at the same
time. 3 times. Why that 3 times is happening? Because? Because there is a hole is there and you have lost the cross-sectional area actually. Okay. So, and the value is how much? So, the distribution will be like this. So, here anyway, it will be P by A only. But here it will be 3 times this one. So now you should be able to say where it is maximum. See, in this cross section, say where it is maximum, near the hole actually, you followed, right? And its value also, you should know, 3 times P by A. This is an upper number. So now anyway, now what is meant by clamping action?
Near the hole, the value is 3 P by A.
That is fine. Now, next question I'm asking, 7, okay. What is clamping action?
So, when we heat the rivets and make them go through the hole, it gets compression force acts on it.
And finally, what happens due to this clamping?
Friction action? Generates. Friction.
Excellent. Now, that is in rivets, but in HSFG? HSFG, how are you generating friction?
Tightening
the screw, that's all. That 3/4 I showed you, right? Once it is already fitted, say, snug tight, then you make a 3/4 rotation, say. Then automatically it becomes a tight, friction gets generated. Fantastic, okay? That's what, anyway, next question is also related to that one only. So all of you have answered. And now how does HSFG bolts resist load?
Friction.
No, not by friction. There are two things are there, I told you, right? What are those two? Anyway, next question also is linked.
Okay. It has two design philosophies. One is with slip and without slip.
Slip part serviceability and bearing at ultimate. Okay. Or slip at both the edges also. That is how the resist load. Now, after slippage, how to design HSFG bolt?
Like a normal bolt.
Normal bolt, fantastic. Now, what is a pitch and gauge?
Spacing between bolts, parallel to force and perpendicular force, smaller and larger.
Follow, that is how they do. Fantastic. Now, what are prying forces? We discussed in last class and just forces. Starting. It is forces. Where do you see this?
Forces that induce bending moment in the bolt, I think.
Not only bending. See, that is the edges, I told you, right? So, if you are having a bolt like this, say, okay, connection here. So, if it is subjected to, you followed, right, this type of tension, say. Now, what happens? This edge, whatever we say, right, it is like a crowbar, okay? So, you would have seen that crowbar here. So, this gives you additional, the force. That is what we call as a prying forces. See, pry bar, you type in Google, say, you will get pry bars, crow bars, to pull out nails, the same philosophy. That is a prying, and of course, bending moment also will be there. Bending moment is nothing but tensile compressive stresses only, this type of thing itself. Well, and now what is block shear? What is a block shear failure? What happens to your connection?
Shear failure at a junction of bolts.
So shear, block shear means what? Whole thing is coming. So how many possible planes will be there?
Two.
What are those two? One is?
Yielding and rupture.
One is a tensile, other one
tension
is shear.
Shear yielding and tension rupture.
Okay, two types of combinations you have. Okay, now what do you mean by efficiency of the joint? Just now we calculated the problem.
Strength of bolt per pitch by strength of plate per pitch.
No, not strength of the bolt, strength of the joint. Okay, so strength of a joint means you have two things. One is a bolt, one is a plate also, the tensile failure. So whichever is small you have to take, and then you have to upgrade the solid plate. So this is efficiency. And now how many modes of failures are there for a bolted joint? I showed you, right, videos and the previous you followed, right, the failures. So how many types modes are there?
Six.
No, I don't want the number, just name actually. Okay, what are those six, just name?
Shear failure and
Shear failure, double shear, or whatever it means, depending on this one. Shear failure and then
bearing failure in bolt.
These are the most important thing you should remember. Okay, shear failure, bearing failure, then
bearing failure in plate will be there.
Plate will be there. Then
tension failure in plate.
Tension failure, tensile rupture or something. The tensile failure will be there. Then
I don't know the name, but the plate breaks into half near the edge.
Okay, that's a tensile rupture. Okay, in the edge. Okay, that is this one. Now, another the most important thing is just now the previous question, 14th question.
Block shear failure.
This also you should tell. That is fine. Shear bearing tensile, if you see block shear, that is more or less sufficient. And now why square root 3 comes in shear? I told you last class.
Von Mises equation.
Excellent. So you should know Von Mises theory of failure. So there are so many theories are there. Truska's theory, Mohr Coulomb theory, Rankine's theory. But for ductile materials, we use, there's Von Mises. So Von Mises stress is nothing but it is related to... You remember what is that? It is related to which one?
Ductile materials, pure shear failure.
No, that is fine. But how do you calculate that one misses this one? Last class I told stress tensor, what you have to do?
Sir, we take root 3 times P2.
No, that is fine. But what do we call that one? See, instead of the formula.
We take deviatoric and sigma tropics.
Excellent. So deviatoric part of the stress tensor, invariant you have to compute. Okay, So excellent. So if you take the invariant of the deviatoric part of the stress tensor, say, so that is linked to your von Mises theory. So from there you substitute, you will get the square root 3. So that is a very, very important theory. All of you in steel, say, von Mises, you should remember, okay, because you will be using that next welding, say, if you want to combine forces and others, you will use that itself, okay. So that is a very important. So if all of you are able to answer, if you know these 17 questions, that means you people are doing fine, okay. If there is a problem, say, maybe you have to go back and study the lectures or this video or this textbook or whatever, so it will be clear, okay. So this is a checklist, very, very important. Now tell me,
sir, parallel is slip or parallel is no slip?
No, parallel means?
Like parallel and wasted shunt.
Parallel means slip at ultimate load. And okay, no slip at service load. Wasted means no slip at ultimate, no slip at obviously at the serviceability. Also, there is you will not allowing the bolt to slip at all, at any cost. Okay. Okay. Then, but the wasted thing, the problem what happens is if you want to design as a wasted shanks, because you are not allowing at ultimate, you are not allowing at any this one, the number of bolts will be high actual, okay? It will be expensive, okay?
Okay, sir.
But that is required, okay? Some electron, if they don't tolerate, say, displacement or something, then you may have to design for that also, okay? So, fine. So, this is a checklist. I suggest all of you please go through this one, and then, if there is any difficulty, you can contact me, or you just see any textbook or the videos, you will be able to find out the answer, okay? So, now, anyway, so with this, we close our bolts, but we will come back to bolts when we discuss that eccentric movement resisting, that other connections, that is the beam column joints and others, we will come back to once again, okay? So now let us see welding actually. So all of you, I think, you know this welding, okay? So you would have seen, in nearby your houses, there are small shops will be there, they do welding actually, okay? So because welding is not only civil engineering or steel, but ordinary, say, like a chair piece has broken, some metal piece or something to join, in your bike, everywhere we use this welding. So welding is essential, it's a mechanical subject. Your mechanical department, say, in our IIT or any colleges, they have to study one course, on welding, you followed. So they will have a full-fledged course itself. And metallurgy, mechanical things will be there itself, okay? But now we will not go into the metallurgy and all other details. We will see as a design, say, how to choose how do I do the design of a weld? Like, how much length I have to do the welding? What should be the thickness of the weld? So that is what I am interested actually in steel design, okay? So, for that, you should know little bit basics about welding, little bit only, not in detail. So if you're welding, as all of you know, right, it is basically joining the metal pieces. So the metal pieces, the original things which you want to do this, that we call as a base metal or a parent metal also sometimes, so together by heating, you heat them to some points, that molten, the filler material. So this electrode or something comes, mixes with the base metal to form one continuous piece itself. So this is what we call as a welding. This is a broad definition of welding. So welding process, it involves melting the metal at the joint and fusing it with additional metal from what we call as is the welding rod actually. Okay, I will show you also. So this is a welding rod, there will be welding rod you followed. So that fellow will be carrying, and then, it welds and sits on the base metal near the joints, and it fills that joint such that both of them fuse together and forms a continuous piece itself. Now, since you have to melt the metal, you have to use electric arc also, by electrification or something you have to do, or oxyacetylene torch also. This is used in gas welding, okay? So once, so you have to heat with this, and once it is cooled, so the weld material, base metal, they form continuous and homogeneous joints. That is a thing, okay? Now, generally in welding, what happens is the welding rod, whatever you see, it will be coated actually. We use a coated welding rods, okay? See, the problem is you have seen, right, whenever you have seen some people doing welding, near the shops and others, you will see lot of gas, comes out, lot of smoke will be coming out basically. The reason for that smoke is, because there will be a coating on the welded rod basically. So where this coating is very, very important. If this coating, if it is not there, so when you are melting the material, say, what happens, oxygen in the air, it goes inside the moisture or oxygen. You remember when I think in the first unit, say, I told you, killed steel, semi-killed steel, you know, we discussed these words also. Any of you remember what is a killed steel, semi-killed steel? Any of you remember? Can you memorize this one? Long back we discussed when manufacturing of steel, you know, the hot molten material comes to say. Then I told, you know, oxygen they blow. Okay, so then to remove the impurities like, you know, sulfur, sulfur, if it is there in the, this one, say, it becomes oxide and it goes away. Then after that, you have to remove the oxygen. So when you remove the oxygen, deoxidization process, we say. Otherwise, if you oxygen, if it is there in the molten materials, so somewhere, you know, that doesn't solidify. When the material is becoming cool, you know, it forms small, small, you know, voids will be there in the this one. And that, so if you remove full oxygen, so we call it a killed steel, semi-killed steel will be there. So now in welding also, because you are doing welding near the field, basically. So then, you know, oxygen anyway will be in the air. It may go inside and, you know, you can have other kinds of problems. So we do this coated rods, basically. So this coating is used for, you know, to remove this oxygen, to prevent oxygen entering that, you know, the weld portion. Okay. So this portion is, that's what we call as, you know, shielded, you know, the arc, you see the process. Okay. So this is a terminology we use, shielded arc. If you don't shield the arc, oxygen may go and then, you know, you will see other kinds of problems itself. So now the process of welding, say, it is a very, very complex. Okay. It is a very difficult, you know, thing itself. And the strength of the welds is highly dependent on, you know, the metallurgy is very important. What type of material, what type of welding, this one, then the welding procedure, how that fellow is doing the welding, the skill, basically, you know, the welders, you know, they should have some degree. I think ITI or some diploma courses are there where they will be taught, you know, the nicely how to do this welding. Because if that fellow doesn't do welding properly, right, because, you know, you may not heat it, cool it or something, you know, other problems will come. So we have IS code also, okay, how to do the welding, what should be the welding rod, you know, IS 816, IS 9595. So they discuss about this welding. Okay, so I will just show you. So this is what we call as oxyacetylene torch. All of you have seen this torch. You would have seen, no, in outside your house, you know, when there is a welding, say, where do they use this type of a torch? Anybody idea? This oxyacetylene torch, how do they do? How they generate heat?
So they have two tanks of oxygen and something, other gas.
Yes,
and then that's comes to contact and.
Yes, yes, that's a gas. Generally, they use gas to generate heat, actually. Gas cylinders will be there, you know, you would have seen also, okay? So this is how the welding process comes. Or if you, gas they use, sometimes they use the power supply also. So then, you know, you will have an electrode and then, you know, the base metal is, like, for example, you say this is a base metal, okay? Or the parent metal we call. So this is a word, parent or base metal means where you want to do the welding, okay? This is a welding rod, okay? So you can see the welding rod here. Okay, so there will be a coating on the top side of the rod. So this coating is basically, it gives rise to these type of gases actually, okay, because to prevent oxygen or something, you know, that oxide formation, they do like this. So when you are heating it, say, so this electrode gets melted, you followed it, so this whole portion melts and then sits on this, you know, the parent metal actually. So this is how the welding, you know, comes. So this is our weld metal actually, basically. So this is how, you know, it forms. So these are the electrodes. You can see here the electrode. Now, so how do they look like? Now, you can see here the electrode. So you can see this by outside, you can see, you know, this white one, this is all, you know, a coating. You followed the coating they use to prevent oxygen and other oxides and other. So this is also a typical welding rod actually. So they, these welding rods, say, they start with E, you know, this is a word they use, E8010, like we have done, no, M24, M40, you see, like a concrete with, right, right. So welding rods also have a classification, EX40, some number, you know, they give, okay. So the, and the another thing is the yield stress of these rods are very, very high actually, okay. The yield stress is, you know, the minimum itself is a 330, 360 like this. Ultimate tensile strength is, you know, it will be very higher actually. So when you compare this with the mild steel, say, which are strong? Mild steel is strong or weld metal? These electrodes are strong. Which has higher strength? What is the yield strength of mild steel? Mild steel?
250.
Yeah, 200.
250, excellent. So 250 is the yield stress of mild steel. Now for your welding, say, you can see the welding rod, the, you know, the yield strengths are very high, 330, you know, like that it have. Then ultimate tensile strength for our mild steels is Fe410, we write. So 410 is the ultimate tensile. But for the welding rods, say, you can see they are very high actually, almost 500, you know, like that. You see these numbers will be, you know, very, very high. So the weld metal is, you know, much more stronger than, you see, this parent metal also. Why do we do this one? Why do we select electrodes or this weld metal to be stronger than the parent metal? What's the reason?
So that the connection will fail first. I mean the member will fail first.
Be careful. Okay, so we want same design philosophy. Whenever there is a, we don't want the welding to break at any cost actually. Okay, so the weld metal is of higher strength, say, so then member fails but the connection remains strong. Okay, that is same design philosophy. Excellent. Okay, so this is the same thing you see we use in welding also. Same what we did in the bolted connections also. Okay, so these are the type of welds actually. Fillet weld, we say. You can see this figure. So fillet weld, so two plates you take, say you do welding here actually. Okay, so this is the welding, or bottom side also you can do, or you know, if you want to connect this flat with respect to this one side, do welding here like this. So this type of welding we call as a fillet. Actually the fillet word is comes from a fillet. So fill it means, you know, you have to fill the this junction with a weld metal. So this fillet became fillet actual in a steel design. Okay, then we have butt welding also. So this plate set to join, you are putting one above another and you are joining. Other way is you put the plates here, this plate here, the parent metal, and you do welding in between actual. Okay, so this you fill this entire region with the weld metal. This is also one way. So this we call as a full penetration. There is also partial penetration also. Sometimes in some designs you say you may have to do, but the strength will be very less compared to full penetration. Don't do full one. So this is one plate, this is one plate. So you do like partial, you followed it, the welding also. This also people do it in practice. So this is also butt weld. You can see fillet means outside you are doing, but butt welding, say, between this plate and between this plate itself you are doing a welding. Okay, then we have plug and slot welds also. Like you say, you have one plate, you drill a hole, you pour the weld metal inside actually. So this is what we call as a plug weld, or you can create, like you say, the slot weld also. I will show you here. You can see here this is plug weld. So this is one plate, this is one plate. So you could do a drill a hole, the shear punching, you punch a hole or whatever. So this you fill with the weld material. You followed. So the welding is, you know, dumped here. So this becomes a plug weld actually. So this is what type of welding this is. Can you see here what type of weld it is? Fillet or, if you go by these definitions, a fillet, butt weld, or what type of welding it is?
Fillet.
Fillet, because welding is outside. So fillet weld, this is how it looks. Now what is this welding? So you have one metal here, parent metal. This is another plate here. Now you have filled that. You have done the welding. You followed it like this. This is a full or partial?
Full.
Full. It is a full only. Okay. No. What is it? It is a full only. Be careful. Partial means it will not reach the entire. But here, he has reached this entire. Of course, here the little bit. This is there. This extra things. Whatever he has provided here, actually. So this they call as reinforcement. Like in concrete, you have seen, right? Reinforcement means steel. But in welding, say, excess, if you like, you know, this much is sufficient actually. But if you something, if you provide excess in welding, we call this as reinforcement actually. Okay, these are the terminology we use in welding. Okay, so anyway, I think time is over. So I will stop here. So the next class, we will see how to design, you know, the weld actually, the fillet weld or this butt welding, you know, the same as lap joint, butt joint, say, how to do this one in our next class. Okay. So if you have any questions, you can ask. So let me go. Stop recording.